knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
In the previous tutorial, we introduced the ray-finned fish, and we focused on their external anatomy and quite a few body systems. Now let's talk about breathing, buoyancy, and regulation. Respiration in the bony fish works much the same way as in the cartilaginous fish, with some notable differences. But first, it's important to note that fish do not split water to get oxygen. That is, they don't actually take in the oxygen portion of H2O. In order to provide oxygen to their mitochondria, they must take in dissolved oxygen from the water, just like we take in oxygen from the air. Fish can and do suffocate in water if the dissolved oxygen content is too low. This is the main reason that fish tanks require bubblers and filters that allow water to splash into the tank, since these methods help to force oxygen from the air into the water. It's also one of the main causes of death for goldfish, since they actually require frequent water changes and higher levels of oxygenation. Without bubblers, filters, and regular water changes, many poorly cared for pet fish end up suffocating. Now, it is common knowledge that fish pull dissolved oxygen out of the water by using their gills. These gills are composed of thin filaments that are folded repeatedly into plate-like lamellae that have dense concentrations of blood vessels. These many-folded gills are located within the pharyngeal cavity and are covered by the bony operculum that protects the delicate gill filaments and streamlines the body. Muscles attached to the operculum pump water over the gills and out the gill slit. Fresh water moves in through the mouth and out the operculum. Let's take a closer look at this process by zooming in on a cross-section of a single lamella. Note that the percentage of oxygen is always higher in the water than the blood. This is because the less oxygenated blood enters in the opposite direction of the flow of water, so that there is always a concentration gradient, which means the oxygen will passively diffuse into the blood in a process known as countercurrent exchange. This is extremely efficient, especially compared to concurrent flow, where diffusion would only be half as thorough. So oxygen moves across the thin barrier into the blood vessels simply because of the lower oxygen concentration there. So then, if fish are really just trying to filter oxygen out of the water, why do they die when they're out of the water? The answer to that has to do with surface area. Since fish gills are comprised of multiple folds, they actually have a very large surface area, but only when suspended in a liquid. On land, they begin to dry out, and those tiny finger-like projections stick together, thus restricting their ability to capture oxygen. In addition, some bony fish, like the herring and mackerel, are obligate ram breathers, meaning they can only obtain sufficient dissolved oxygen by swimming continuously, forcing water into their open mouths and across their gills. However, there are many species that can survive outside of the water for extended periods of time. Some, like the snakeheads, can move over land to get to new ponds, while others, like the freshwater eels and mudskippers, can also absorb oxygen through their skin as long as they stay moist. Still others, like the Indian climbing perch, spend most of their lives on land near the water's edge and respire using air chambers located above their reduced gills. Buoyancy in the ray-finned fish is primarily controlled by the swim bladder, which is a gas-filled organ in the dorsal coelomic cavity, just underneath the vertebral column, that is also involved in respiration and sound production in some species, such as the drums and croakers that have sonic muscles attached to or near their swim bladder. Physiologically, the swim bladder resembles a tetrapod or lobe-finned fish's lung. This is because these structures all share common ancestry. The swim bladder is thought to have evolved from the lungs of ancestral fish and is found in most ray-finned fish, but is absent in some groups, such as catfish and some deep-sea species. Ray-finned fish can adjust the amount of gas the swim bladder contains, which can change the fish's overall density, making it easier to maintain a specific depth in water. Gases like oxygen diffuse into the swim bladder by way of the gas gland. Gas from the blood is moved into the gas gland by the reti mirabile, a complex array of tightly packed capillaries. In order to release gas, a muscular valve is opened, thus allowing gas to enter the ovale and then diffuse back into the blood. Osmotic regulation is key to survival in the ocean, and in bony fish, it is mainly controlled by the urinary system. This is essentially the process by which an organism maintains a stable internal balance of water and solutes in relation to its external environment. As such, freshwater and saltwater fish face very different challenges. Freshwater fish are hyperosmotic regulators because water tends to enter their bodies osmotically and salt is lost by diffusion. This is because fresh water is a very dilute medium with an average salt concentration of 0.001 to 0.005 molar, while freshwater fish blood has a much higher salt concentration at 0.2 to 0.3 molar. Thankfully, their bodies are scaled and mucus covered and nearly impermeable to water, but water gain and salt loss do occur across the thin membranes of the gills. In order to combat this, freshwater fish must pump excess water out of the body by their kidneys, which form extremely dilute urine. This helps rid their bodies of excess water, and to sequester salt, they have salt-absorbing cells within the gill epithelium that actively move salt ions from water into the blood. Marine fish, meanwhile, have the opposite problem. They are known as hypoosmotic regulators and have a much lower blood salt concentration, around 0.3 to 0.4 molar, than the surrounding salt water, which is about 1 molar. This means they lose water and gain salt, such that in a saline environment, saltwater fish risk drying out as their internal water is passively lost to the surrounding seawater. They must therefore drink a great deal of seawater and remove excess salt, often by salt excretory cells located on the gills that release salt ions carried by the blood. Their kidneys also uptake excess ions and excrete water that is highly concentrated, in direct contrast with the dilute urine of the freshwater fish. Due to these very different environments, about 90% of all bony fish are restricted to either a freshwater or a saltwater habitat. They can only survive within a very narrow range of salinity, so releasing a freshwater fish into a saltwater habitat would result in death. Likewise, saltwater aquariums must maintain the proper salinity levels. However, about 10% of ray-finned fishes are capable of passing between habitats of varying salinity levels. They are collectively known as urehaline fishes. Some of them, like the flounders and killifish, live in estuaries and intertidal areas where salinity fluctuates daily, and are able to both actively uptake salts and excrete excess salts depending on the salinity of the surrounding water. Other urehaline fishes, like the salmon and eels, spend part of their lives in freshwater and part in saltwater, so they undergo physiological adaptations, such as changes in kidney function and water permeability of their gills, to cope with different salinity conditions. Finally, the last topic to cover is reproduction. This can get rather complicated, so let's move forward and look at that next.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.